This series looks like a lot with the series against the Nets. After the first three games, the score is exactly the same. How much do you think that this can motivate you so you can eventually get where you want to go in these finals?
You know, we talked about it some between or, you know, after game two. That just I do believe there's reference points. There's things that you can learn throughout the season. There are things that you got to draw on. It doesn't guarantee or fix or, do more than just give you that reference point. And the players have talked about it. We've talked about it. There's things from series to series, regardless of how they've gone, where you can draw on them. And whether it's offensive concepts, defensive concepts, you're just building habits. You're building reference points that you can draw on that, you know, build confidence and give you opportunities to go out and compete.
Over here in the second row.
Hey, Coach. I don't know if you saw after the game, but Monty took issue with, I think he said one guy, but Giannis taking more free throws than your entire team. So two parts. One, curious your reaction to that. And now both of you, and I know yours was different after game one, you even joked about being baited into it, being asked about the refs, but you guys have both brought up free throw numbers after games. I'm curious, is there any intent behind doing that in a press conference? Have you seen any benefit to that in your career?
I mean, it's like the age-old, you know, ritual of the playoffs, and I guess historically or experience-wise, I don't know that it has any impact, and probably could argue I've seen it go both ways, and some organizations, some players, some teams, you know, actually feel like they're penalized for doing it, and at the end of the day, I actually think the referees just call the game. They call the game, and coaches go and talk about the game, and we'll do the same thing after tomorrow night's game. And we have the best referees in the league, and we're always still frustrated with them. And they're still the best in the world. It's really it seems like it's always the same. And I don't think it has any impact on the game.
Dwayne on the right.
Yeah, Coach, when you look back at the film, what are a couple of things you felt like stood out that maybe not beyond Giannis's numbers that maybe underneath the surface, but you saw, okay, this was a big factor as to why we won the game?
I think just, you know, defensively, the connectivity with the group was you know, where it trending in the direction we needed to be, just really communicating, covering for each other, you know, all those things that you need to do to be good defensively, the connection. Really, we kind of use the same word offensively, the connection offensively, the way the guys play together, move together, just playing basketball. I think, you know, it's a sport that takes everybody participating, and just felt like we had all five guys more connected on both ends of the court, and we got to just get better even going forward in that sense.
Jeff in the middle.
Mike, you've touched on this a little bit, maybe in this series and the last series, but it's so difficult for a second rounder to end up as an all-star. What did you see from Chris Middleton when you weren't coaching him, when you were coaching Atlanta, and then, you know, for him to get to the point where he's an all-star, what have you seen here?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think seeing him, you know, as an opponent from a distance, you know, his shooting really stood out, just to very, very gifted shooter and with great size, ability to kind of shoot and make shots, you know, tough shots stood out. I think the thing that's really since being around him every day, just his work ethic, his professionalism, but as far as a player, the ability to be a playmaker and grow as a passer, I think that that's been a huge part of our growth, you know, and maybe he did it more before, just, you know, sometimes you don't see it and pick up on it like you do when you're around everybody someday, but the playmaking, I think he's an underrated defender, his size again, you know, just what he does at 6'8", you know, he's a really skilled, gifted, smart basketball player. His IQ, I talk a lot about his IQ, it's off the charts, and he sees and reads and understands things very quickly and at a very, very high level.
I don't know if this is something you consider, that you're essentially your two best players. One is a second rounder and one is a, you know, just at the end of the lottery draft pick. That doesn't happen very often. Do you consider the good fortune that takes?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think there's a lot of good fortune there, you know, for both, you know, Chris and Giannis to end up here and now being together for 7-8 years. I think it's that they've been teammates and kind of building this together and trying to get to this point. And I think it speaks to being able to build, you know, championship level teams different ways. There's not just one way to make it to the NBA Finals. And, you know, John Horst and our ownership and Giannis and Chris, you know, the stick-to-itiveness, to belief, to build around those two guys, along with a lot of good fortune. It's always a little bit of both.
Jim in the second row.
Hey, Mike. Brooke was saying the other day that in terms of watching Giannis or sort of seeing what he's doing, and him, Brooke, meaning like he's trying to appreciate it and sort of understand, I guess from your chair, is it hard to do to I don't know if it's called reflect, but when you're in the moment and it's always about getting better moving forward, to kind of take in the, you know, the air that he just sort of entered in this finals and you know, the injury and all that stuff. Have you allowed yourself that at all? Or is that a, you know, an August sitting at home thing or 10 years down the line thing?
No, I mean, I think wrapped in the question, it's the most interesting part, you know, is I think the coaching staff actually we want more, you know, so I think it's like not only, you know, it's probably wrong or not, you know, to not appreciate what he does. And we do appreciate it. I don't want to, you know, it's very, very special. But in the heat of the moment, you know, we're constantly just, you know, I think pushing Giannis that he can give us even more, and pushing the group that they can do even better and give us more. And it's luckily, I think Giannis likes being pushed. He likes being coached. And so you kind of, that's more the mindset than, but you know, I think every day we come to the facility, Giannis is appreciative of what's there. You know, coaches, we're appreciative to have such a good team. And, so there's a you know, awakening every day where you're appreciative and then you kind of get in the gym and you push and you want more. So I don't reflect on how great he is probably enough or really very often.
Brian in the back.
Anyway, I want to ask you from your years with Coach Popovich. I remember him talking for many, many times about, you know, that team having corporate knowledge. The guys were together and just kind of knew how to do things. Now he's got the Olympic team and doesn't have that. Is that something that's a difficult adjustment for any coach, or do you expect kind of 2 years or 2 minutes, whatever, you'll figure it all out?
No, I mean, it takes a lot of time to figure things out. There's no replacement for, you know, reps and experiences and being defended different ways and having to, you know, navigate different things defensively. And, you know, it's a little bit like the, you know, Chris and Giannis, they've been together for so long that I you can just see and feel some of the things they do that are very just instinctual, very just kind of without thinking about it. And I think as a team, we're a long ways away from that, but there's parts of our group that has that corporate knowledge, and I think we're fortunate to have, as you know, many, you know, particularly Chris and Giannis and Brooke being together for the last 3 years, and now Drew mixing in and Tuck mixing in, and Pat, somebody off the bench that has a lot of corporate knowledge, is really helpful. So no, you can't get that in 2 minutes or two games or, you know, a couple practices. It's real and it takes real time.
Tim in the front.
In game two, Mike, Phoenix had 17 attempts on corner threes. In game three, I think they only had three. What did you guys tweak there, and how sustainable do you think that is to keep them limited there going forward?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's something that if we can, you know, try and make everybody uncomfortable, try and, you know, make all the shots contested and difficult. But, you know, certainly the three-point line hurt us, you know, particularly game two, Bridges and Crowder and Cam Johnson. You know, so it's a great challenge guarding Paul and Booker. They tend to attract extra attention, draw an extra body, and they're willing passers. So the better we can do on Paul and Booker, you know, hopefully the better we can do reducing, you know, particularly corner threes are real, you know, I think that's a hot spot for any offense, and defensively, if you can limit them, it's real helpful.
Dave here in front.
Bud, you just mentioned the better job you could do on Paul and Booker. Booker had his worst game of the series offensively after pretty strong games in games one and two. Anything that you guys implemented specifically that you felt like worked and helped stop him from scoring like he did early on in the series?
I think we felt like we got a little bit better from game one to game two, and hopefully we did the same thing going from game two to game three. And he's a great player, but he's human, you know, but I think we're expecting, you know, we're going to have to be even better on him. But being able to throw different people on him, Tuck is an individual defender, and then Drew's abilities, and sometimes Chris and Giannis, and Brooke is his own way of, impacting things. But I wouldn't say there was one specific thing or anything we did different. Obviously, there's subtle little things that, we're trying to do, but we just got to be prepared for a really good Devin Booker going into the game four.
Steve on the right, last question in here.
Mike, as the legend of Bobby Portis Jr. has grown, did you, when he first got here, have any conversations with him about what level of being amped up is good and how much maybe, how far to go without going too far?
Not when he first got here. I didn't know what the legend of Bobby Portis Jr. would be. But certainly throughout the season, there's been, some moments where trying to find that balance of whether it being keeping your focus, going to the next play, being prepared, for a defensive possession or just keeping your mind, in a good kind of mental space and focus. But at the same time, having that great energy, he brings great energy to our team, to our arena. And he's let me know that he does that. it's been kind of a fun journey with him to have those conversations. Sometimes it's in the heat of the moment and sometimes it's on, an off day or between games, but his passion is so real. I think the way his teammates respond to him and appreciate him and love him, it's all real. And so I probably should just, step aside.
Given that emotional connection he has, particularly with fans in this building, have you or would you go to him ever just for that sort of energy burst, even if it's not a basketball X and O type of situation that needed him?
I think at the end of the day, we need to play good basketball, and Bobby plays good basketball. I think the crowd responds to him playing good basketball. I think it always starts with that. He's a really good player. He does a lot of things defensively, offensively, and certainly they love his personality, love his passion. But at this time in this moment, you got to play, you got to deliver, and he does that. So it's luckily it's a win-win.
Thank you, Coach.
Yep.
All right, Dwayne in the front. First question.
Whenever you're ready, Coach. No, I'm just checking. You got the mask on and you take it off.
Was a license for me to leave.
No. No, not yet. A couple questions at least.
Two?
Well, two for me.
Okay,
I don't know about everybody else. No, just real quick. You usually, obviously, when you watch the film, have a better grasp of what you saw. What's your takeaway from after seeing the film?
They took it to us. No other way to look at it. They played with a great deal of force, 50-50 balls, attacking the paint. We had spurts of playing the way that we play, but certainly not as consistent as we needed to. And I think I said that the other day, but they, from the first possession of the game, we had a bad transition, defensive lapse. They get a three, corner three in transition. And that was, a credit to them. They played with a great deal of energy and they were physical. We were physical, but they were physical from the jump. And, the more I looked at it, it was like I can sit here and make excuses about what we didn't do and, all of that. But they played at a high, high level.
Quick follow. You guys usually get the corner threes and it just was limited in game three. Did they do anything different or was that just a lack of maybe you guys not focusing on getting
No, I think they did a really good job of running us off the line. they were intent on, you know, closing out and then bringing someone else as the game wore on. And even in the third quarter, you could see, you know, we were starting to figure out some things, but not as consistently as we needed to.
Kellen, over here.
Hey, Monty, was that three you were talking about, the one for Holiday at the start of the game?
Yeah.
So on plays like that where you want the attention to be on Giannis, obviously, and focused on him, but you don't want three or four guys, yeah. And there were a few possessions like that. What's the delicate balance there between the team defense of focusing on Giannis but not to a point where it leaves guys open like that?
Yeah, it's not delicate at all. It's a hard truth that you have to do both. You have to be able to show a wall but also have the integrity of your defense intact on the other side. And that particular play was a bit of an anomaly because normally he's attacking and, you know, it could be a clear side. That particular play, Drew just sprinted to the corner. We had no awareness of that. They kicked it three. But to your point, you have to do both. There's no in between with this team. And when you can do both, you can have success.
Eric, here in the front.
Hey, I was just talking to PJ Tucker about when you defend Chris Paul, no pick and roll is the same because he's so good in kind of manipulating things. We've seen Drew Holiday mix it up against him defensively. I'm curious if you could speak to just kind of the ways in which Drew might not give you the same look every single time defensively.
Yeah, I mean, he's a guy that I coached in New Orleans, so I have, you know, some history with him in that regard. You know, he's a guy that can, you know, judge where he is on the floor better than most. And so he knows when to get under. He can tell the kind of screen that's coming. So he can, if it's a flat screen, he bulldogs over top. If it's a different type of screen, he gets under. Like, he just has that instinct. I don't think it's anything that anybody taught him. He just knows how to do it. And so this, in the same way, he manipulates on the defensive end. That's who he has been his whole career. If you look at him from Philly to New Orleans to now, he's been one of those guys that can get through screens or get under and get back to the ball.
What does that kind of do for you guys offensively, knowing that he will do those different things?
It just forces us to be more sound in our screening. Like, you can't change your screen just to fit what he's doing. That you know, I don't think that's something that we will spend a lot of time on. There's certain things that we can do that I won't share with you all, so you can go tell them. But it's just, we want to be as consistent as we can to try to get a hit on those guys. Connaughton's another guy. PJ's another guy that can get over a screen. And Middleton's better on defense than people give him credit. So there's a reason why they've been a really good defensive team the past few years. They have guys that know what they're doing.
Hey, Monty, after last game you said you didn't want to complain about the fouls, but then you kind of did the next sentence. I'm curious, the reason for doing
that. Is that like a jab or
I'm just curious, the reason for bringing that up at a press conference is what?
Well, somebody asked me the question, like, how can I help DA? So I answered it. And then the free throw disparity is what it is, so that's what I did. They had one player with 17 free throws, we had 16. That's not complaining, that's stating facts.
I'm sorry, Dave, here in the center.
Now that Yarn warmed you up, but asking completely off topic on that, you mentioned force. You've said that same terminology other times during this playoff run. How do you define it? Like, what do you want to see out there that lets you know the guys are playing with force?
It's typically not the first play that we had in transition. You know, when we get five guys back along with attacking the offensive glass and get guys back, I know we're playing with force. 50-50 balls. You know, we couldn't come up with those balls. There was a play where Giannis dove. Devin got a palm on the ball. We couldn't get it. The ball hits Mikhail in the face. We couldn't get it. Cam Johnson had it. We couldn't get it. Giannis ends up with it and dunks the ball. Like, those are the kinds of plays that we just could not, you know, make go our way when we're playing the way that we know we can play. The offensive rebounding, you know, Torrey didn't have one. He's a guy that just falls into it, you know what I'm saying? And then just both ends, just the relentless sprinting, getting to the corners on offense, defensively getting back and showing a wall. That was what we thought was inconsistent, and our players thought the same. When we watched film yesterday, they were all in agreement. When we do it, we give ourselves a chance to be successful. It's not the panacea for any, you know, any stretch of the imagination, but it does help us play the way we want to play.
I'll take the last two questions in the back row.
Hey, Monty. Before game three, you kind of laid out the levels of concern with the offensive rebounding, the points in the paint,
yeah,
the honest free throws, and then those things happen in game three. Were yeah. you disappointed kind of that you sort of knew how they were going to attack you and then they went out and did that yeah. attack plan?
More at myself, you know, because the messaging wasn't where it needed to be to get our guys to do it. Like, our guys know it, but I was thinking about me. You know, my messaging to the team, and was that adequate enough? Obviously, players have to do what they're supposed to do, but we know it. Didn't, you know, on my part, when I look at how we prepared to get ready for this game, I was like, man, that's – I have to do better. You know, that's – and then our players, you know, they get in line with that. You know, I think they look at themselves – internally and think about what we all can do better. So I think across the board, we have to have a better understanding of the kind of team that we're going to play. You know, from here on out, they're going to play that way. And I'm not quite sure I got that across to our guys strongly enough.
Vince.
Monty, you played for Pat and Van Gundy and Doc and Pop, a bunch of guys who liked – kind of needling the media a little bit or needling the league through the media in the course of a playoff series. Do you see value in that? Have you seen situations where things that they've pointed out as a point of emphasis has actually worked in the next game because they pointed it out, and do you subscribe to that?
I don't know if I can do it. It's just not my personality. And the one thing that Pop taught me was to be myself. And I do think it's finite and it's ability to change anything. Ultimately, I think the players are going to go out there and do what they're going to do to help win the game. I'm not quite sure if it helps as much as people would think. Maybe it does. I don't know, but I'm not good at that stuff. I tend to state the facts. I try to be respectful. I want to go through the proper channels and get my point across. I don't want to play the game that way. It's just not who I am. Maybe I'm wrong in that, but I do get your point. I've seen coaches implement that. I know I'm not that good at it.
You know, it looked like that the other night, though, right?
Maybe, but it wasn't intentional. But if it works, great. You know, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's I stated the facts. I wasn't pulling something out of a cloud. You get where I'm coming from? Like, those are facts. That's what it was.
Thank you, Coach.
Yep.
Chris Paul will be right up.